Okay, bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Quick review, brothers, from last week's topics. And obviously, don't look at your notes as reviewing. So we were talking about last week the shurut of salah, okay, the conditions of the prayer. And the week before, what is the definition we gave for what is a shurut? What is the definition of a condition? Linguistically and technically. So either give me one or give me both. Anybody remember? I couldn't hear you, bro, again loudly.
That which means absence, necessitates an absence.
Yeah.
When it's present, does it necessitate?
Exactly. So that which in its absence doesn't necessitate, that when its absence necessitates an absence. Okay, ما يلزم من عدمه العدم ولا يلزم من وجوده الوجود. But if it's present, the condition, it doesn't necessitate the presence of the action. And the example we gave for that was wudu, for example. If you don't have wudu, which is a condition of prayer, there's no way you can have the action of the prayer. But if you do have wudu, which is the condition of the prayer, it doesn't necessitate that you're going to have the prayer. There are other things that prevent you from praying, okay? So this is the first thing. And linguistically, what does it mean? Huh? A sign, okay, like Ashrat al-Sa'a, the signs of the Day of Judgment, for example. What did we say that the meaning of awra was? Its meaning, linguistically. Exactly, so it had the meaning of aib and naqs. It comes from the word awra, okay, which has the meaning of aib and naqs. That if you lose your awra, or you expose yourself, your reputation and your standing in society becomes deficient, okay? What's the awra of the man according to the imam? If anybody else wants this, he's getting it myself.
From the navel to the knees, from not including the knee.
Exactly, from the navel, what is between the navel to the knee, okay? And what type of awra is this in the categories that we gave? Mutawasita, right? This is mutawasita. What about the woman? What's her awra? The awra of the woman? Excellent, mashallah. Everything apart from her hands and face. And what type of awra is this from the categories that we gave? Ahsant, mughallada, right? Extreme. Okay, and then we have the awra of a young boy. What's the awra of a young boy between 7 to 10? The private parts only, the front and the back. And this is mukhaffafa, okay? Very good. Jazakallah khair. Why is the prayer in a stolen thobe, according to the imam and those who agree with him, impermissible? Or why is it invalid? Sorry, not impermissible. It's impermissible according to everybody. But why is it invalid if somebody prays in a stolen thobe? Why, according to the imam and those who agree with him, if somebody prays in a stolen thobe, his prayer will be invalid. It won't be accepted. It won't be sahih. It will be fasid. They don't make infikak al-jaha, right? They don't separate between the two, okay. So what it is that according to the imam and those who agree with him, al-nahi yaqtadi al-fasad, that a prohibition, if it's found in an act of worship, it dictates that the act of worship will be incorrect, invalid, okay? So what you mentioned was a proof for the other opinion, that you can separate between the two. Very good, jazakallah khair. What is the ruling of praying in silk or wearing silk for a man? Yeah, so raise your voice a bit more, but I think you were saying that you're allowed to wear it if you have a skin condition, for example, and you can't find another fabric that will help you relieve the condition that you have, okay? But what's the ruling then if we say to somebody, what do we say to somebody about wearing silk? We say it's impermissible, right? Because the Prophet ﷺ forbade it. Except for in this case, which the brother mentioned.
What about manufactured silk? What did we say about that? Very good. So you mentioned part of the answer, but there was another part before it. Manufactured silk? It's permissible in essence, but if it's too close to silk in its texture and its look, then it's better to avoid it. We can't say it's impermissible, right? It's permissible, but it's better to avoid it. Why is it better to avoid it? Because like the brother said, may Allah give him good, people may look upon you as doing that which is haram, right? That you're wearing silk, right? What about praying with your shoulders uncovered? What did the Imam say? One of the shoulders should be covered, so you shouldn't pray with your shoulders uncovered, right? And what was the reason we gave for that? No. The hadith is there, clear, that the hadith said, according to this opinion, that you shouldn't pray unless you have one of your shoulders covered. But there was an illah that we gave. Something to do with the awrah, that in those times they would wear one piece of clothing many a time, right? And if there was nothing wrapped around the shoulder, it would mean that it could easily become undone in the prayer and they would expose the awrah. So due to the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا يُسَلِّ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي ثَوْبٍ وَاحِدٍ لَيْسَ عَلَىٰ عَاتِقَيْهِ مِنْهُ شَيْءٍ. Okay, make sure that you're covering one of your shoulders. But the majority said this is recommended. طيب, if there's not enough clothing to cover the awrah, how does the person pray? So for example, his awrah is uncovered. He doesn't have clothing to cover his awrah. How should the person pray? He should pray sitting down and with gestures, right? يُمِئُ بِرَأْسِهِ. He should make gestures, okay? But what if he's alone? He can pray standing. It's better to pray standing because that's the asl. وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ. Allah says, and stand in obedience to Allah. So the asl is to pray standing, right? When can you pray with the najasa on your clothing? What situation did we mention? That somebody has najasa on his clothing and he knows it's on his clothing, when is it permissible for him to pray with that? Or when is he allowed to pray with that? Because the najasa must be avoided, we know this, right? But in what situation is it permissible for him to pray with the najasa on his clothing whilst he knows? I can't hear you, bro, sorry. Very good. So you're saying that's the only one he has, right? Exactly. That's the only piece of clothing he has. And the time of the salah is about to finish. Okay? So the time of the salah takes precedence over the removing of the awrah. Okay? That he has to pray within the time. If he had enough time, he could wash it or he could go get another piece of clothing. Tayyib? What if somebody prayed with najasa, but he forgot about the najasa? Yani he knew that he had najasa on his thobe, but he forgot during the prayer. And he only remembered after the prayers. Is salah valid or invalid? Okay, so I said he prayed with najasa on, but he only realized after the prayer. Okay, it's valid. Why is it valid? What's the hadith? Do you remember the? Remember the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ when he prayed and Jibreel alayhi salam came to him and told him that he had filth on his shoes, and then he removed his shoes, and then the Prophet ﷺ said that if one of you comes to the masjid, check his shoes. So to the end of the hadith. But the point from the hadith was that the Prophet ﷺ didn't restart his prayer. He was told that he had filth on his prayer, so that which is done due to forgetfulness, it's overlooked. And we went into more detail about that. What do you do if you have najasa on your thobe and you remember while you're praying? So you have it on your thobe, you've realized it's there while you're praying. Huh? Good. What do you do? So you break the prayer and you... No, you don't break the prayer. What do you do? You try to remove it, okay? Unless it's going to cause something which will make you break the prayer, like too much movement or exposing your awrah. In that situation, then you break the prayer if you have time and you start again. Tayyib, what's the ruling on your prayer if your awrah is uncovered during the prayer? What's the ruling on the prayer if your awrah is uncovered during the prayer? Huh? In all cases? What did we say? You're right, you're correct. Okay, sorry. If you realize you cover it right away and it doesn't affect your prayer, right? What else? Exactly. If it's a lot and if it's uncovered for a long period of time, then your prayer is invalid in a nutshell. Jazakallahu khairan. Tayyib. So continuing with the condition of avoiding, of having tahara min al-najasat fi badnihi wa thawbihi wa mawdi' salatihi. Okay, that was shart al-rabi'. The fourth condition where he said that you must have purity from filth in your clothing and in your body and in the place that you are praying, okay? So we finished the body and we finished the clothing. Now we're just going to talk about quickly the place in that where you are praying, okay? As part of that condition. So that Imam rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, وَالْأَرْضْ كُلَّهَا مَسْجِدٌ تَصَحُّ صَلَاةٌ فِيهَا. That the whole of the earth is a masjid and you can pray in it, okay? Anywhere in the earth, you can pray. That is the asl, okay? That is the foundation ruling. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ said in Bukhari and Muslim, جُعِلَتْ لِي الْأَرْضْ مَسْجِدًا وَطَهُورًا فَأَيُّمَا رَجُلٍ مِّنْ أُمَّتِي أَدْرَكَتُ صَلَاةً فَلْيُسَلِّ. The Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, that the whole of the earth has been made for me a masjid and purification. So any person from my ummah that reaches him the time of the prayer, he should pray. Meaning wherever you are, you pray. So this hadith, it shows us the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon this ummah. Because the ummah before us, they could only pray in the places of worship. But for us, we can pray wherever we are. Going back to the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, Masjidan wa tahuran. It's a masjid for me, the whole of the earth, and it's tahur for me. Purity for me. Purity for me. What does this mean? Tayammum, ahsant. Purity here means it's tayammum. If you can't find water, you can use the earth and you can make tayammum, okay? What if a person is praying on the earth somewhere, but he has doubt? Like he sees, for example, dogs around, and he's not sure if this particular area is pure for him to pray in or not due to having dogs not too far off. Maybe they did something. What does he do in that situation?
Is doubt enough?
Good, you're in the right, you're thinking correct.
Certainty overrules
doubt. Ahsant. Certainty overrules doubt, but how did you get the certainty? This is what I'm trying to get to. That's the point. So the asl is, we go back to the asl, right? So all of what you said was correct, but the asl is that the hadith said that the whole of the earth is pure for us. So if you have doubt, we stick to the asl, which is that the earth is pure for us, and this was mentioned by Sheikh Abu Bakr Sa'dawi in his explanation. The Imam, he says, illa al-maqbara. So the whole of the earth is pure for you. Now he's going to give you exceptions. He said, illa al-maqbara, except for the graveyard. Because the Prophet ﷺ said in, as in Sahih Muslim, لا تصلوا إلى القبور ولا تجلسوا عليها. Don't pray towards the graves and do not sit upon them. And the Prophet ﷺ said in Bukhari and Muslim, لعن الله تعالى اليهود والنصارى اتخذوا قبور أنبيائهم مساجدا. That Allah Azza wa Jal cursed those groups from amongst the Christians and the Jews who would take the graves of their prophets as places of worship. Okay? So it's something that the Muslim has to avoid. We're not allowed to pray in places of worship. And this is one of the signs of Ahlul Bidah and Ahlul Sunnah. Ahlul Sunnah, they go to the graves in order to remember death and in order to give dua to the people who have passed away. But the Ahlul Bidah, they have so many innovations and practices which are not sanctioned by the Prophet ﷺ pertaining to the graves and those who are in the graves, okay? What is the reason for not being allowed to pray in the grave apart from the prohibition of the Prophet ﷺ? Can we understand an illa? Is there a reasoning for not being allowed to pray in the graves, do you think? Yes, it's a matter of aqeedah. How is it a matter of aqeedah? Jazakallah khair. We prefer to stop people from falling into shirk, as many people fall into the ummah and the ummah that came before us, right? So it's a prevention of for people to fall into any type of shirk. As we see in our ummah today, people make tawaf around the graves of the dead. People go to the graves and they make dua to the dead instead of to Allah. So much shirk is taking place. But if people follow the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, not to take them as places of worship, there wouldn't be any worship that takes place near the grave whatsoever. And also another illa that some of the ulama they mentioned is that it could be some najasa there. Because when the dead decomposes or something might have come out of the body which wasn't cleaned, and it could seep into the area close by the grave. Okay, this is also one of the reasons that some of them mentioned. Tayyib, what about praying in a masjid that has a grave? Brother says no, we want some tafsir. We want some more information. Anybody? But you're correct, it's no. The Prophet ﷺ is a separate issue because the Prophet ﷺ, his room was not built to be in the masjid itself, his grave. That's a separate situation with regards to historical context. But in general, the ulama, they say that if, and this is what Shaykh Muhammad Salih ibn Taymin said in his fatawa Nur al-Dar, he said, if you go to a masjid and the masjid was there before the grave, the masjid was there before the grave, you are allowed to pray in the masjid as long as the masjid is, the grave is not in the Qibla. You're not facing towards the grave for praying. So if the masjid was there before the grave and the grave is not in the direction of the Qibla, you can pray. But if the grave was there, okay, before the masjid, okay, then regardless of where the grave is, in which direction it is, you can't pray in that masjid. Tayyib, is that clear? Tayyib. Then the imam, he says, then. Sorry, again, because I couldn't catch all of it.
The masjid is a certain distance from the grave, and there are five established salat there.
Yeah, yeah. If the masjid is outside, yes, jazakallah khair. We're talking about if it's found inside, if the grave is found inside the masjid. But jazakallah khair. You want to hold your questions till later, inshallah? We'll have time for them, inshallah. Unless it's urgent, you have to ask now.
Yeah, so what if it is?
Even in that case. And Allah knows best. The Imam, he says, the next place that you cannot pray is the hammam. What's the hammam mean? Huh? Exactly. This is what we understand from hammam, right? Bathroom. But it's not bathroom. Hammam is the bathing places that people used to bathe in. And it comes from the word hamim. What does hamim mean that you have it in the Quran many times talking about the hellfire? It means boiling water, okay? So hammam comes from the word hamim. And it means the places where people used to go to bathe. Okay, so the Prophet ﷺ said, as in Tirmidhi, al-ardu kulluha masjidun illa al-hamam wal-maqbara. That all of the earth is a masjid, except for the hamam, the bathing places, and except for the graves. The hadith in Tirmidhi. Okay, so it's prohibited. So why is it prohibited to pray in the hamams? Is there an illa? Is there a reasoning? Imam An-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says the reason is because in that place, the aura of the people, sorry, he said, this is the place of the shayateen. Shayateen will visit this place. Okay? So he said, for that reason, the Prophet ﷺ prohibited it. Other people, they said, it's also due to the fact that you will find people uncovered there. The aura won't be covered, so it's not suitable for you to pray in that place. And the third thing that the Imam, he says, from the istithnat, from that which is not allowed to pray in, as a place, he said, does he say, what does he say there in your book? Is it al-hawsh or al-hush? In Arabic, if someone can read it. Is it al-hawsh or al-hush? طيب مو مشكلة, we'll take it al-hush. Al-hush, okay, is another place where you cannot pray. Al-hush comes from, or has the meaning of bustan. Hush means places where people relieve themselves, like toilets, bathrooms, okay? Why it has the meaning of bustan? Because in the time of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they would go to the places where there would be palm trees to relieve themselves, right? They didn't have places to relieve in the houses. They didn't have those systems. So they would go out and they would relieve themselves in the places where there would be a gathering of grass or palm trees, where they could hide themselves and they would relieve themselves there. So obviously this is a place where you cannot pray. Why? Because you find najasa there, and also because you have shayateen there. And then the Imam, he says, وَعَطَانْ الْإِبْلِ, the stables of the camels. The Prophet ﷺ, as narrated in Sahih Muslim, narrated by Jabir radiallahu anhu, أَنَّ رَجُلًا سَأَلَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أُصَلِّي فِي مَرَابِدِ الْغَنَمِ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, can I pray in the stables where the sheep are kept? The Prophet ﷺ said, yes. Then the man said, أُصَلِّي فِي مَبَارِكِ الْإِبْلِ, قَالْ لَا. Then the same man, he said, Ya Rasulullah, can I pray in the places, stables, where the camels are kept? And the man, the Prophet ﷺ said, no. So you can pray in the places where there are sheep, but you cannot pray in the places where there are camels. Okay, this is forbidden for you to pray. Why? Why cannot you pray in a place in the stable of camels? Huh? Not the filth.
Jinn?
Huh?
Jinn, because after you eat camel's milk, you have to...
Exactly. Exactly. So this is what Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said. He said, because they created from the jinn. Okay, and this is mentioned in the hadith as well. And like the brother correctly mentioned, that according to the majority, if you've eaten camel's meat, you have to make wudu from it. And also, another illah that they give, another reasoning they give for not praying there, is because the camel, being created from the jinn, is very erratic, right? Always moving, always angry. It's going to take from your khushu in the salah. It's going to take from your khushu, which is a fundamental pillar of the salah. You're not going to be able to concentrate, and it may harm you if it escapes. The next thing that the imam he mentioned, for an exception in the places that you cannot pray, he says, وَقَارِئَةُ الطَّرِيقِ قَارِئَةُ الطَّرِيقِ قَارِئَةُ الطَّرِيقِ is generally a pathway that people use. قَارِئَة comes from the word قَرَعَة, which means knocking, okay? And طريق, as we know, is the pathway. What does it mean, knocking of the pathway? It means the footsteps of the people will be knocking on that pathway. So you cannot pray in the pathway, according to our imam and those who agree with him. Why? Because you're disturbing the people, ahsant. And this is something beautiful about our religion. We consider always the feelings and the needs of the people, right? You consider always the feelings of the needs of the people. And also, because again, it will take away from your khushu. You're praying in the pathway, people are bumping into you, people are crossing in front of you, you can even break your salah. But what if the pathway is empty? It's not being used. Can you pray there? Sheikh Abdulaziz al-Rajihi, in his explanation, he said you can, because according to him and that group of ulama, the hadith is weak. The hadith is weak, which says, wherein the Prophet ﷺ said, not to pray in those pathways, okay? So according to those scholars, based upon their understanding of the hadith, they say it's permissible and Allah knows best. Moving on to shart al-khamis, istiqbal al-qibla, facing the qibla. Those of you who have come across Arabic before, Qaisan and others, what does alif, sin, ta stand for in Arabic? For example, when I say astaghfirullah, alif, sin, ta. Talab, right? It means talab, that you're seeking something. Alif, sin, ta always comes with the word of talab. Okay? Astaghfir, I'm seeking information. Astaghfir, I'm seeking forgiveness. So istiqbal, you'd think has that meaning, but it doesn't have that meaning. It's not that you're seeking the qibla. It's as Muhammad Muqtar al-Shaqiti, he said in his explanation, Hafidullah, he said it's hikayatul fi'l. Hikayatul fi'l means it's just what you are doing. You're not seeking, it's showing what you are doing. What you're doing is you're facing the qibla, okay? So that's the meaning linguistically of istiqbal al-qibla. So when you see the alif sin ta, it's not from the other meaning of seeking. It's hikayatul fi'l. It's just showing what you are doing. So Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ وَحَيْثُمَا كُنْتُمْ فَوَلُّ وَجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَهُ. So put your face in the direction the Prophet ﷺ is told of the Qibla. And the believers, wherever they are on the earth, face in the direction of the Qibla of the Masjid al-Haram. This is in Surah Al-Baqarah. So this is the foundation principle, right? When you want to pray, you have to face the Qibla. طيب, if you're on a plane, on a journey, which many of us do, and the plane is not facing in the direction of the Qibla, and neither are you able, after seeking permission, you have to seek permission, after seeking permission from the stewards or stewardesses to stand up and pray somewhere, you're not able to do that either. How then do you pray? You're not able to face the Qibla, and nor can you get permission, they won't give you permission to get up and pray. What do you do?
Do the best you can.
Do the best you can. Is that what you were going to say? Start off and then you carry on wherever you were. Okay, good. I like that. That's. So what the brother said about doing whatever you can, that's correct also, but there's something we have to add. So Shaykh Taymin rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that if it's a salah that you can make jama' taqdeem for or jama' ta'akhir, okay, then you have to do that. Generally, I suppose it will be jama' ta'akhir, because you didn't know you couldn't face the Qibla until you were on the plane. So you couldn't have prayed that before. So what does jama' ta'khir mean? It means that you join the salah at a later time. So for example, dhuhr, you will join with asr. So if you know that you're going to land in the time of asr, you pray the dhuhr with the time of Asr whenever you land, because that way you can fulfill the condition of facing the Qibla. And likewise, what other prayers can you join? Maghrib and Isha, okay? So if you can do that, make Jam' al-Ta'khir, then that's what you would do. If you can't do that, and you've asked the stewards, and you can't face the Qibla, even if it be to start with the prayer, and then carry on where the flight is going, as you mentioned, then you pray in any condition that you are in, because you've done to the best of your ability, right? Fear Allah to the best of your ability. Then the Imam, he says, so after setting for us the principle, which is that you have to face the Qibla, the Imam now, he gives you exceptions. He says, إِلَّا فِي النَّافِلَةِ عَلَى الرَّاحِلَةِ لِلْمُسَافِرِ فَإِنَّهُ يُصَلِّي حَيْثُ كَانَ وَجْهُهُ. Except for the one who is praying a nafil salah on a riding beast or something of that sort whilst he is traveling. So three things. He's doing what? He's praying a nafil whilst he is on a mode of traveling, whether it be a riding beast or something else, a car or a boat or whatever, and also whilst he is traveling. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ, as mentioned in Sahih Muslim, by Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي سبحته حيث توجهت به ناقته. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, as according to, narrated by Ibn Umar in Sahih Muslim, would pray his nafil prayer, his subha, okay, in any direction that his riding beast, his naqa, his camel would take him. So there's the proof, right? The Prophet ﷺ wouldn't face the Qibla. He would pray in any direction, but it would be a nafil, it would be traveling, and it would be on his riding beast, okay? Just another interesting point linguistically, the hadith said, يُسَلِّي سُبْحَتُهُ. Subha, this word, it means nafil. How does it mean nafil? Because subha comes from the word tasbih. Tasbih, according to the majority in the prayer, is not wajib, it's recommended. And also the nafil prayer is recommended. So subha has the meaning of nafil, that which is recommended, okay, the recommended prayer. So what we said, that the Imam said, that if you're traveling and you're on a riding beast and it's a nafil, you don't have to face the Qibla. But many of the ulama, they said that when you start the prayer, if able, you should face the Qibla, because there's a hadith which allude to this. So if you're able to do that, start the prayer facing the Qibla, even in the nafil. Tayyib? May? Then the Imam, he says, وَالْعَاجِزُ عَنِ الْإِسْتِقْبَالِ. And also the person, another exception of the one who doesn't have to face the Qibla, is the one who doesn't have the ability. He's unable to face the Qibla. For example, he says, لِخَوْفٍ, due to extreme fear, أو غَيْرِهِ, or other than that, فَيُصَلِّي كَيْفَ أَمْكَنَهُ. So he prays as he is able to pray. So if somebody is being chased by an enemy, in a state of war, or he's just being chased by an enemy, he's in an extreme state of fear, he cannot pray facing the Qibla, okay? He prays however he can. And also if somebody, for example, is in hospital and he's unable to move to face the Qibla, there's no one to move him, then he prays in the situation that he is in, because Allah Azza wa Jal says in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ فَرِجَالًا أَوْ رُكْبَانًا. And if you are in a state of fear, فَرِجَالًا, meaning on your feet whilst you're moving, أَوْ رُكْبَانًا, meaning riding, wherever you are riding, in a state of war, in a state of fear. So this gives us the principle that if you're in a state of fear or anything similar to that, then you do not have to face the Qibla because you are unable to. Tayyib, you're in, la samhallah, may Allah not permit, you're in hospital. Or somebody's in hospital. Okay, Bilal? He's lying on the bed. He can't get up himself to face the Qibla. How should he be faced towards the Qibla? Should he be feet first or head first? Should his head face the Qibla or should his feet face the Qibla? Probably if it's your father, he's going to say, don't put your feet towards the Qibla, right? So, what should it be, feet or head?
Feet.
Neither. Huh?
Neither.
Neither.
You can't turn your bed around.
No, but so, okay, so in this case that I'm mentioning, somebody's there. Somebody's going to turn you around. But which way should he turn you? Should he turn you your feet towards the Qibla or your head towards the Qibla? Good thought, but no. Why feet towards the Qibla? That's the one. That's the one. Jazakallah khair, ahsan Allah ilayk. So if you were to stand up, you'd be facing the Qibla. But if you did it headway, you'd be away from the Qibla, right? This is also mentioned by Sheikh Muhammad Mukhtar al-Shanqiti, hafidhahullah, in his explanation of the book. Tayyib. Then the Imam, he says, وَمَا أَعْدَهُمَا. And apart from these situations that we mentioned, لا تصح صلاته إلا مستقبل الكعبة. your prayer is not going to be valid unless you are facing the Kaaba. Okay? فَإِنْ كَانَ قَرِيبًا مِنْهَا لَزِمَتْهُ صَلَاةً إِلَىٰ أَيْنِهَا. If the person is close to the Kaaba, then you have to pray as though you are directly facing it. So if there was a line from the Kaaba to you, it would be a straight line. This includes, as Sheikh Muhammad Mukhtar Shaqiti, he mentions, he said, if you're in the masjid, then for sure you have to pray facing the Kaaba. Even if there's a wall between you and the Kaaba, you have to find out and you have to check. So in Masjid al-Haram, we know it's very expansive. You have to know for sure that you are facing the Kaaba. It's not enough to guess. If you're not sure, you have to ask somebody. You have to find out. You have to make your juhud. You have to expend your energy to try to find out to the best of your ability. Taib, if you're outside the masjid, what do you face? You face the masjid. If you're outside Mecca, what do you face? You face Mecca. Taib. So then the Imam, he says, وَإِنْ كَانَ بَعِيدًا فَإِلَىٰ جَهَتِهَا. And if the person is far from Mecca, then he faces towards its direction, as we just said. Because the Prophet ﷺ, as in Tirmidhi, he said, مَا بَيْنَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ قِبْلَ. He said, that which is between the east and the west, for those who are far away, is the Qibla. So that which is between the east and the west is Qibla. So this also shows us the ease of our religion. So sometimes you find people, they go to the masjid and they make a lot of complaints about the masjid not being completely in the right direction of the Qibla. And they're using their new technology. This is takalluf. This is making things difficult. You don't need to do that. As long as it's not completely far off, the direction between the east and the west, brother's laughing because maybe he found one far off, right? Or people purposefully didn't face the Qibla because they wanted to fit more rows. So they purposefully made it away from the Qibla so they could keep it in the angle that they want. This is wrong. But in general, we have to face in the direction of the Qibla if we are far away from it, and our religion dictates for us ease. Now the Imam, he says, وَإِنْ خُفْيَتْ عَلَيْهِ الْقِبْلَةُ فِي الْحَضْرِ. If the Qibla is unknown to him whilst he's resident, meaning whilst he's amongst people in a town or a city, سَأَلَ, then he has to ask, وَاسْتَدَلَّ بِمَحَارِيبِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And then he also, if he cannot ask somebody, he's in town, he has to look at the mihrab, the maharib, because this shows you the direction of the Qibla, right? The mihrab. Where is it? Is it there, right? So there's a few things here. Why is it that we tell him that if you cannot find the Qibla whilst you're in town, then look to the mihrab? Why? Because it's unlikely, the ulama say, that a group of Muslims will come together and each of them, or most of them, will agree on the Qibla being in the wrong direction. So generally how the masajid used to be made, they would bring the people of knowledge together and the people of experience in, of determining where the Qibla is going to be, and they would come together and determine where the Qibla was. So you can trust that a group of people have established that the Qibla is in the correct place. But again, in our day and age, it's a different story. Tayyib, when we said that ask a person, which type of person should he ask? He should ask a local resident and somebody who seems to be trustworthy. Not somebody's walking around with something in his mouth, right? Or doing some naughty stuff. This person is fasid. When it comes to issues of the deen, you don't ask somebody who has fisq, okay? Somebody who has openly sinned, because you can't trust that person. Tayyib, and what is the proof to say that we can ask one person to determine for us the Qibla? How can we put our act of worship on the trust of one person? What is the proof of that? Historically, is there a proof or a proof from the religion? There's a few proofs. Tahweel al-Qibla. When the Qibla, the Muslims, they used to pray towards Bayt al-Maqdis. They were in the Salah, the ayah came down, the Prophet ﷺ sent one of the companions to go inform the Muslims. And what they did, whilst they were in the Salah, after hearing the Muslim, the Sahabi, tell them that the Qibla has now been changed from Bayt al-Maqdis to the Kaaba, they changed. So they took the testimony of one Muslim. Right? So the testimony of one practicing Muslim suffices. So what did the Imam tell us? He said, if you're in town, right, you don't make your own ijtihad. You follow the mihrab. And if you can't follow the mihrab, you ask somebody who's practicing, okay, from that town, and that's what you do. Then the Imam, he says, فَإِنْ أَخْطَأَ فَأَلَيْهِ الْإِعَادَ. If the person makes a mistake because he made ijtihad by himself, he made his own exertion on trying to reach that opinion, he made ijtihad by himself, then he has to repeat the salah. Why? Because he didn't take the means which were available to him. And the qa'idah, the rule, okay, according to many in the fiqh, is al-qudratu ala al-yaqeen tamna'u min al-shak. Al-qudratu ala al-yaqeen. The ability to have certainty tamna'u min al-shak prevents one from doing something with doubt. So your prayer with doubt wasn't valid because you had the ability to do it with certainty. طيب. And the Imam, he says, وَإِنْ خُفِيَتْ فِي السَّفَرِ اجْتَهَدَ وَصَلَّ وَلَا إِعَادَ عَلَيْهِ. But if you're a traveler, obviously there's no one around you, you have to make ijtihad. And even if it was found out later on that you prayed in the wrong direction, you don't have to repeat your salah. Why? Because you did the best of your ability. Then the Imam, he says, وَإِنْ اِخْتَلَفَ مُجْتَهِدَانِ لَمْ يَتْبَعْ أَحَدُهُمَا صَاحِبَهُ. That if there's two people, you're traveling with a group of people, and amongst your group, there are two people who have knowledge, and they know how to determine the direction of the Qibla. But both of them are differing, right? Then the two that are differing, they're not allowed to pray behind each other. They're not allowed to pray behind each other. So two of them, they have knowledge of how to determine the direction of the Qibla. But both of them are differing. One's going left, one's going right. They're not allowed to pray behind each other, okay? Why? Huh? They won't accept, that's obviously good, jazakallah khair, but why, from a fiqh perspective, huh?
One of them is wrong by default.
One of them is wrong by default according to his ijtihad, right? According to his ijtihad.
Yeah.
So, Shaykh Abdulaziz al-Rajihi, he said in his explanation, he said, look, he said, you have Salatul Jama'ah. What's the ruling of Salatul Jama'ah? What's his ruling, is it Sunnah or is it Wajib? Salatul Jama'ah. Wajib, right? It's wajib if you fall into the being in the vicinity. It's wajib, right? But what is the istiqbal al-qibla? Facing the qibla, what's that? Shart. Shart takes precedence over the wujub. So according to me, I have to fulfill the shart because I know it's that way. Yes, I want to pray in jama'ah, but I can leave off the jama'ah because it's wajib. It's not at the same level as a condition. And I know that the condition is fulfilled in that direction, not that direction, according to my ijtihad. So I have to go with the condition and not the wajib of praying in jama'ah. The exception to this is if those two who disagree, but they agree on the general direction. So one says, no, it's more to this way. The other one says, no, it's more to that way. But generally, they both agree that it's the same direction, it's west or it's east. So according to some ulama, that they can still pray in that situation. Other ulama, other ulama, stay with me brothers, other ulama, they say even in the situation of them differing, they're allowed to pray behind each other. So Shaykh Abdullah Tayyar, in his explanation, he said this. He said, for example, if you're going to pray behind the imam who has eaten from the camel, like you mentioned, but his opinion is that you don't have to make wudu. His opinion is what? You don't have to make wudu from eating camel meat. But your opinion is that you have to make wudu from eating camel meat. So according to you, the imam doesn't have wudu. But according to himself, he has wudu. Okay? So it's allowed for you to pray behind him because this is how the companions radiallahu anhu did so. They differed in these issues. So for example, Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala was asked about, can I pray behind somebody who didn't make wudu from blood? He said, كَيْفَ لَا أُسَلِّي خَلْفَ سَعِيدِ ابْنِ مُسَيِّبْ وَمَالِكْ. He said, how can I not pray behind the great tabi'i, Sa'id ibn Musayyib and Imam Malik, who have this opinion that you don't have to make wudu from the blood, right? And also, Shaykh Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned that the way to understand it is if that the salah of the imam is valid for himself, then it's valid for you, even if you differ with him. The important thing is that the imam who is leading, if his salah is valid according to his conditions and his understanding of fiqh, then it's valid for the one who prays behind, even if you're differing with him. Again, the beauty of this religion, it causes us not to differ so much. Why do we differ so much? Because we don't have knowledge. We don't know the knowledge and how the behavior of the imams who came before us. One brother is always telling me that in his masjid back home, they fight over the most ridiculous of things. They nudge each other after salah, your salah wasn't valid, brother, go and do it again. I mean, subhanAllah, this kind of behavior has to stop. First and foremost, we don't have knowledge, so we don't have the right to say this to people. We can say to them, brother, I think this, but not for sure you have to, because we're not imams, we're not people who are scholars. So this type of behavior, we should stop it, and we should realize that fiqh is flexible and it's a lot deeper than we think it is. Tayyib, just to finish inshallah, how long have we been going for, brothers? Tayyib, we'll stop on this inshallah. In fact, we'll stop here because the next point is quite important and I don't want to rush it, inshallah. So Jazakumullah khair, may Allah Azza wa Jal reward you for your efforts and make it heavy in our scale of good deeds on the Day of Judgment. Anything which was correct was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any shortcomings and mistakes were from myself and shaitan. Any questions you have, feel free, inshallah.
Yeah, I have a question on Salat, why you travel.
We're going to come to this if you can wait for it. Are you going to be with us in the future? We're going to do Salat of the Traveler.
Sure.
If you can wait for it, we'll do that, inshallah. If pertaining to what we took now,